approximately 4,000 nautical miles between New York Harbor and Troy. On patrol, he searches out and deters polluters, monitors tributaries and waterfront facilities, conducts a water quality sampling program, and takes regional decision makers and media out on the river so that the river has a chance to advocate for itself. Please welcome Jon Lipscomb. Way down to the table, which has been pushed as far forward as it can be, so we can make room for the many people here tonight. Next, I would like to welcome Artie Carlucci. He is an environmental science teacher here at our own Ossining High School, and he is, I think you are actually a returning panelist. I know you've come to documentary discussions, so we're so pleased to have you here with us tonight. Artie has taught environmental science at Ossining High School for the last 12 years. He's been a teacher with us for 20 years overall. As a Fairfield University grad, he worked in the energy field as an engineer in the southwestern United States and in the Gulf of Mexico. But he's been a high school science teacher for 35 years, as I said, the last 20 of which here in Ossining, where he also teaches advanced courses on the Long Island Sound and the Hudson River. Along with his teaching duties, he is working with the Ossining educators and students on a water quality sampling project at the Ossining waterfront in partnership with Riverkeeper, with the goal of the sampling to open the beach at Ossining for swimming. So please welcome. Welcome Zephyr Teachout. Her name is probably familiar to many of you because if for no other reason you may have seen her on a ballot, but she is mostly a political activist and she's an associate professor of law at Fordham University. And she holds her BA from Yale University and both an MA and a JD from Duke. She was the first national director of the Sunlight Foundation, a nonpartisan organization that works to make Congress more open and transparent. Zephyr has dedicated her life to the fight against corruption for public schools, broadband, clean water, and small businesses and farms. We can talk to her about everything on the list all night long, but Zephyr, please join us. I had the pleasure of being on a radio show earlier this week. This is our first chance to meet in person, so glad you're here with us. And last but not least, we have Rob Friedman from he is the environmental justice campaigner for the National Resources Defense Council. He focuses on climate and environmental justice advocacy efforts for at the NRDC. He helps facilitate alignment and build principled partnerships between the NRDC and grassroots communities across the country on a number of issues, including fighting fossil fuel infrastructure, that sounds familiar, advocating for safe drinking water, and centering equity in the development and implementation of climate policy. Before the NRDC, Rob worked on water quality enforcement and community engagement at Riverkeeper in New York's Hudson Valley. He holds a degree in environmental policy from Bates College and is a trained organizational behavior coach through the Academy for Coaching Excellence. He is with us here tonight. Rob, please join us. Welcome. I'm going to start us off with just a really simple question, and then when you do, please do talk into the mic. There's a lot of folks here, and you have to hold it closer to your mouth than you wish you did. You don't have to go first, sorry. My question would be, there's so much that we saw in the film and so many efforts that you all are working toward. Is there one element that either frustrates you or concerns you the most that you see again and again in these issues? And it could be something that has to do with the challenge itself from an environmental science perspective, or the political climate, or the people you're dealing with. I'm gonna give them a second to think. And then you all be ready to ask your questions, and let me just let you know, we have to be out of here at 9 o'clock.
No.
Everybody wants the last question because there's gonna be so many great things to talk about, so, but we have to have a couple of minutes to take a picture with our panelists afterwards, so. Everybody had enough time to thank you, ready to answer your question. Okay, Rob, thank you very much.
Cool. Hey everyone, good evening. It's an honor to be here with all of you. As was said, my name is Rob Friedman. I work for the Natural Resources Defense Council. And I'm a Riverkeeper alum. I have deep gratitude for Riverkeeper. John was actually my boss when I was there. I learned a lot from him. So. Before I go on, I wanted everyone to just take a deep breath in and out for me.
We're too close to the river.
Yeah. Because Well, everything that was just discussed in the films is obviously...
Hold it close to your mouth. Oh,
okay, thank you.
Yeah.
Everything that was discussed in the films is obviously enormously heavy and depressing and just like, oh, it's so dense. And we just want to be acknowledging that as we move forward proactively. The biggest frustration for me, especially when it comes to fossil fuel infrastructure, is that it often feels like a many-headed hydra. And when you lop off one head, you just slice it off, and another one grows back in its place. Sometimes it grows back with three additional hydras. We need to be thinking about the fossil fuel industry, as Zephyr was saying in the film, as part of a system, and actually taking on a systems analysis of the fossil fuel industry and actually addressing it as such. So despite the fact that we can pat ourselves on the back, as was said, with regard to the fracking ban in New York State, there's a hell of a lot more, pardon my language, infrastructure that's popping up all across the state and the surrounding region. So that's probably the biggest frustration for me.
Thank you, Rob. Thank you all for coming tonight. This is unbelievably impressive, and if there's any goal, take this home with you and carry it on to something else. And I think the good thing about 2017 is that it seems to be going forward. That being said, so I teach high school kids, and you know, they have their naiveties, and they're different areas of the spectrum. And I have to say, you know, the thing about teaching environmental science, and one of the things about science in general, scientific method, is you start off, well, what is the problem? Well, it seems we have quite a few in environmental science. And I guess if there's a frustration that you know, well, GE did this, or ExxonMobil has this going, or, you know, there's a lot of, I think the enormity of some of those who are not necessarily in favor of sustainability and things of that nature. So you got a high school kid, and they have their high school worries about, you know, sports and jobs and girlfriends and proms, all those sorts of things. Well, what about this? And then they look and they go, oh, there's not anything you can really do about it. That's something I think a lot of adults deal with too. But what I've come to find is you need not to present it in terms of problems, but in terms of solutions. And you know, there's, you know, it's an open-ended idea. Okay, what are the solutions to some of these things? Well, that's where I try to bring the science in. Okay, look at all these things. What can we do to solve this problem? Now, if there's anything that could be, I guess, frustrating to go to the question, is some kids are like, oh, well, there's not anything you can do. Well, what you need to do is transcend that, well, there's nothing we can do, and, oh, yes, there is. And, you know, that's, I think, what we have to, that's a seed that needs to be planted, that there are solutions, and is it going to be easy? No, absolutely not. But, you know, just the same, you got to fight the good fight, and you can't give up. So, you know, it's a big, they're up against big odds, but, you know, I see my role is, well, look, you can do this, and that's where I think the solution lies to the problems that are presented.
Thanks. I was just to follow up on that, when I was talking with Anae or on the radio, can you guys hear me in the back?
Yeah.
Okay. This weekend, I have a little pet peeve about people who say we need a technological breakthrough at this moment. We need a political breakthrough as much as we need a technological breakthrough. Sorry, Mayor, I don't know if I'm going to do well on my test, because I don't have an order of the most frustrating things. I'm just going to tell you one. We are talking about poison. We are talking about poisoning ourselves and making people sick and making people die. I visited Megantic after the bomb train explosion. And a frustration of mine is that the Democratic Party, I have plenty of anger at the Republican Party. I'm talking about frustration. I believe that this should not be a partisan issue. but also that I would expect leaders in our Democratic Party to be unwavering in their absolute support for investment in renewable energy and doing everything they can to stop investing in the fracked gas infrastructure as well as in the fossil fuel industry.
So it's hard to follow these guys up. So I would just offer this perspective. The frustrating thing for me is that our system of government is not protective of our natural world, and our environmental laws aren't up to the job of protecting the natural world. So for example, the NRC that oversees Indian Point is autonomous. FERC, as you saw, gets to run over people's properties and their lives. That's not good enough in a democracy. The industry has its way too often. And the legal structure isn't sufficient to protect the natural world. You know, we're on the river and we have this wonderful Clean Water Act. We've had keepers from other countries come aboard our boat. Beijing Waterkeeper, for example, you know. We showed him the worst we had in New York Harbor. We showed him the Gowanus Canal. He was not impressed by what we call pollution. And but we have this Clean Water Act, which is a gold standard internationally, and yet it defines success as water that's fishable, swimmable, and drinkable. All of it usable by us. The fish didn't get mentioned there. The natural life in the water are second to our use of the water. So until we evolve to having the rights, you know, wild law, right to life of rivers and forests, we will not achieve. But, so that's very frustrating because we're up against that system. All the issues you saw here are new in my tenure. You know, I've been on the river 16 and a half years now for Riverkeeper. When we started, there was no Tappan-Zee Bridge issue, there was no pipeline issue, there was no crude oil coming down the river at all. There was no Champlain Express power cable. And I can go on and on and on. All, I kind of assumed that as the years went by, we would be winning. But the pressures are increasing. But then I will say that, you know, Bowermaster, he introduced the films as a downer, as a bummer. I look at these and I look at this room and I actually am not depressed by what I see. I am very happy that we're in the fight. We're in the fight. And when GE dumped the PCBs, there wasn't a room full of people like this. It happened because the public wasn't engaged. And on this issue of anchorages, in 1990, an anchorage was proposed for Hyde Park, right across from the Vanderbilt Mansion. The Coast Guard received 19 comments from the public. This time, the Coast Guard tells us they received more comments than they've received on any issue in the history of the Coast Guard. Comments versus 19. So, yeah, we have problems, but you know what? We're in the fight. So I don't look at this and get depressed. I look at this and I get angry, and it makes me want to fight.
Okay, so I know that all of you have questions, and there's so much good information here. Who wants to go first?
I will.
Okay, speak up. We're gonna forgo the rule that you have to talking sticks because it's so crowded. Go, speak up.
Got it. So I walk around Croton Point every day. I walk around this river with my dog, and about 5-7 years ago, the County of Westchester invested in a major kind of walls that were built where the Clearwater divide was. That's now falling in. So it hasn't even lasted 5 years, maybe 8 years. And what I'm seeing along this river, and I would like your input on this, is I might be crazy, but I'm thinking that it has to do with the railroad. The erosion that's happening, I mean, embankments 20, 30 feet high that 3-5 years ago There's plenty of space to walk the trail. It's now falling in. And I believe that the tidal effects of the oceans rising have something to do with it. But what is the railroad doing? Where do they come in on this dilemma that we're faced? Number one, and number two, you know, how do I bring that to my fellow children in my community of Croton on Hudson?
That's a big question.
Yeah.
And I'm not a specialist. I don't have the experience to really answer you. But Croton Point is an unnatural shoreline. Croton Point was a delta that rose up out of the river. The Croton River Delta rose up out of the river after the lake that formed behind the moraines after the last ice age. That moraine blew out, the river went back to sea level, Croton Point rose up. If you ever needed a way to put your life in perspective, think back that the river is it's like one heartbeat in that's been 15,000 years. And so what you're seeing there is shoreline that's been remanufactured. I don't know exactly where you're seeing the erosion. The sheet pile bulkhead that was built, the fact that that's failing is probably just low-grade steel, and there's salty water in that part of the river. In the areas of the river where there's been no touch by mankind, straight across from you, in fact, on the Hook Mountain side, there's a small stretch of shoreline that is probably exactly what the Indians saw. And that is virtually unchanged. The cliffs that are there are unchanged, the sandstone cliffs. And you know, we see trees knocked down during Sandy and then new trees come. So that area is stable. But when we mess with it, we destabilize it. And I can go on. In the upper part, the upper third of the Hudson River estuary, from the city of Hudson north, in order to make the Port of Albany a deep water port. You know, the river back in Henry Hudson's day wanted to be 6 or 8 feet deep up there. We have charts on board our vessel from 1820. And it was full of islands and full of back channels. And the Army Corps of Engineers dredged a singular channel to focus the tidal current in one place so it would minimize maintenance dredging, filled all the back channels. So all the landmarks that are cold islands are no longer islands. 60% of the shallow water habitat was wiped out. So now we wonder, why do we have fewer herring and why do we have fewer shad? So I guess the answer to your question is the impacts are very local. Destabilization of the shore starts a continuing cycle. I understand that sea level rise has been an inch a decade so far. I don't think that's the real issue yet, but time will tell.
If you didn't know already, Captain John is a real-life superhero. Who knows more about the river than anybody? If you have a chance to go out on the river with him, do it.
Question.
Sorry.
If we could
talk with you.
Go ahead, Chris.
Okay, I'm a kayaker, and I have kids that have swum in the Croton River, or actually, I'm sorry, at the Croton Point Park, there's a beach there, and I heard some pretty concerning things about the river. PCBs, my understanding is that the PCBs were trapped in the sediment. Is that not true? And what's your opinion on the current status of the water for swimming?
The thing about PCBs, the biggest danger is eating food that's been contaminated with them. It's a bioaccumulation thing. As far as swimming, I've swum in the Croton River and at Croton Point, and it's still going. So far, we'll see. But the point is that if you're exposed to it, from what I understand, you shower it off, and that won't. If you soaked in the river every day for a long period of time and ate out of it, I think you'd be in danger. But as far as and the other thing about PCBs, it's tricky stuff. It's an oil. It's people don't, you know, you think PCBs is this chemical. It's a liquid, and it's dense. So what's happened is it's gone down to the river bottom, and it's mingled with the sediments there. It was 40 years worth of sediments, and
you know, it's probably in the sediment there. When we were talking about opening Croton, opening Ossining Beach, you know, my role is we're testing for bacteria there, for fecal coliform, because that's more dangerous than, at this point, than the PCBs. But that being said, you know, we mentioned the role of sediments and what we had to be concerned with, and we've talked to people from the county health board, and they said that's not as much of a concern as the bacteria. So the main danger from PCBs would be a bioaccumulation. So what the man in the film was saying about, you know, eating from there, that's dangerous. Long term, and I think, you know, as if you're in the river for a long period of time, and even like he said, there seems to be upticks of people living along the river and other health issues. You know, I don't know enough about that to comment on it, but as far as the main concern is, and one thing, that we've lost that entire industry to PCBs, and the recovery time, I don't think it's going to be in this century. So.
I just wanted some clarification. You said it was the Army Corps of Engineers that dredged the river and eliminated, was that John? I think you said that?
Yeah.
How long ago was that?
It started in the mid-1800s, and you know, creating a port in Albany, it started with bringing lumber down from the Adirondacks. It, when the Erie Canal was envisioned, we had to get vessels up to Albany. So over time, there's been a progressive deepening of the shipping channel. Now it's maintenance depth at mean low or low water is 33 feet. One of the risks that we're going to have to watch here is that as the Port of Albany is expanded, there could be pressure to deepen the ship channel up the river. We're going to have to be on the watch for that, because we're going to say no to that. The bottom of the channel now has been at that depth for a long time, and so it has become a new habitat. And so we want to restore those side channels in the upper river,
right.
And there are plans to do so. We don't want to, you know, machine the river anymore. And it goes into this whole conversation about anchorages and crude oil transport. The whole attitude of the public to the river has changed dramatically, and we appreciate it as a living neighbor, and we cherish it for that. You know, when Riverkeeper started, it was commercial fishermen and recreational fishermen who went out and started to fight against pollution because they didn't want the fish they were fishing to be polluted. Well, they were using the fish. But now we have this huge community of people who just love the river. They aren't going to benefit from it, but they want to protect it. So we'll be on the lookout for changes in the future.
Thank you. You know, we took a walk on Wednesday on the Hudson, and there were four folks from Riverkeeper. Some of you are here tonight. I see Robin, and Sarah was here, and Jeremy was in the film, was there, and Jen. And we all met up at what we call Henry Gordine Park. It was recently named. And Henry Gordine, for anybody who's in Austin, you know, he was a shad fisherman. And he was a very famous, well, locally anyway, famous commercial fisherman here in Austin. And and if you go down to that park right now, you'll see that there's a kiosk there. It's got a big placard about the history of the river, and one of them is about the fishing industry, the big picture of Henry Gordine. So a little plug for our local park there. And I know there's a million questions here, so here we go.
I need advice. I get many requests to sign petitions by email, and I get requests for donations of money. And I wonder if any of that does any good.
Thanks so much for that question. It does a lot of good, absolutely. The job does not stop there at all in any capacity. As was said earlier, I look out on this in this room and I'm like, this is the manifestation of resistance. People are here standing up to the fossil fuel industry, standing up to GE, proclaiming no longer, not anymore, not on my watch. And that's tremendously powerful. we need to turn this attention and this energy in the direction of engaging directly with elected officials, with the boards of corporations, with the people in charge of corporations. That's vitally important. So a lot has been said, I think, recently about how we need to shift from armchair activism to being in the streets. And I don't call it armchair activism because I think everything is important. I believe in a diversity of tactics. This moment that we're in right now requires a diversity of tactics, but we also need people engaging directly with their elected officials because they're accountable and they're complicit in this as well.
How? So I'm gonna actually ask a lot even more of you. Because like it or not, an enormous amount is asked of you in this room right now. So I'm really glad to see many people here, but one of the reasons it was important for me to come here tonight is to say that coming here tonight is actually not your activism. It's just your learning, okay? It's just, the activism is what comes later, and there is a special responsibility for people in the Hudson Valley, for people in Ossining and in this area, and that responsibility comes from the history. So sorry, but the history of incredible activism in this area means that you're gonna be responsible to do more and to show people in this area as well as around the country what can be done. For the most part, if you have a choice, there may be no harm in signing petitions, but the work that you really have to do is in person, in groups, and persistent. So all of those three things are important. In person, in groups, and persistent. You can also write letters to the editor. You can also, I mean, there's other things besides those, but I want to focus on those as the most powerful ways to make a difference. And John, first of all, this was just great to see his movies on the big screen, because I'd seen them online, and they're, you know, really haunting online, but then they're really extraordinary in person, on the big screen. But one of the things John pointed to, I just really want to point at again, because I know that a lot of people feel like this is impossible. We're up against impossible attacks. We're up against a Trump EPA, right? We're up against an administration that is not only deeply hostile, but may well, in fact, have conflicts of interest. And there's reason to believe that we don't know, because we don't know the tax returns, but that Donald Trump himself has conflicts of interest pushing the possibility. So incredible degrees of hostility. But I want to remember the very specific lessons that we learned from the fracking fight. Okay. As you may recall, people thought a fracking ban in New York State was impossible, actually impossible. And then a groups of people started following around Andrew Cuomo until he dreamt about their faces.
That's true.
Do you remember the number? True.
How many people signed, I'm not asking in this room, yeah. What was the total number of signatures that the governor received against fracking? Something like 40 or 50,000 signatures.
Yeah, that's right.
Okay. There's part of your answer coming.
But one of the things that's important is that, so the fracking ban happened. How many of you were involved in that fight one way or another? Fantastic, right. How many of you were involved in that fight in 2011? Okay, 2012, 2013. 2014. Okay, we're at 2011, right? So I guess my point is that it's gonna be hard. And that to be successful, you have to understand that it is gonna be hard. And thank goodness those of you who were involved in 2011 didn't give up after a year saying we've showed up at every event we can show up at and nothing is happening. But persistent, in person, educated, learning the facts. Local groups came together. I know you have a really active groups here, but learning the facts, taking these films as a starting off point to learn more, and then doing your own analysis about who the most powerful local officials are. I am a huge fan, and I can say this because I have no affiliation, but join Riverkeeper. it's an extraordinarily trustworthy, great science and great activism group. So get involved in those groups. But besides the petitions, I really want, I want to focus on the groups coming together and not quitting after year one and not quitting after year two and not quitting after year three, because it took over 5 years, but we got a bracket in New York. And a lot of people have been involved in Indivisible. I don't know if any of you have been long paying attention to that. Mm-hmm. One of the key lessons, there's two key lessons in Indivisible. One is that what the Tea Party did was in-person events as well, right? But the other is you have to push your own party as well, even when it seems like the other party is the enemy. And so that there's opportunities, that there's, and you have had some great leadership in part because of local pressure, but don't just focus on Republicans, also focus on Democrats because they can do more.
Lauren.
So I'm going to answer you, activists, partners. Members paid for that. Members owned that campaign, all right? Why do petitions count? When there were, you know, we've not only poisoned the fish with PCBs, but we've also overfished them. So we overfished shad in the Hudson. Shad come in from the Atlantic, they spawn in the Hudson. If you want to annihilate a species, you catch it just before it reproduces. And that's how we fished for shad. So the state biologists wanted to eliminate the harvest of shad. The commercial industry was against them. The historians were against them. They were outgunned. And we went to some of our members with those requests for letters that you're talking about. And a group of 22 religious organizations on the Hudson, it's called ROAR, religious organizations along the route. Nuns and monks. Which is an odd crowd for me if you know me at all. But I went to Sister Carol D'Angelo and I asked her if she would please write the state on behalf of the shad, and she wrote a beautiful, beautiful letter talking about environmental justice doesn't just apply to people, and these are God's creatures. And I heard back after the state banned the continued harvest of shad so they could recover, so we succeeded, but I heard back that those letters made a difference. So I can go on and on, but you, by supporting, I'm not asking for anybody, but if by supporting either Scenic Hudson or NRDC or Riverkeeper or whoever, you own those organizations and you're in the fight. You can't go out necessarily and take your own vote and do the work that we do, but you're in the fight. You own part of that effort. And then the petitions and the letter writing, they absolutely matter. The example that Zephyr gave on the fracking, the governor didn't ban fracking because he believes in the environment. He did fracking because of all those signatures. There's your answer right there. Yeah.
Sorry.
The follow-up question was email or letter, which is better. I'm told by people who know better than I that a letter is much better. And a handwritten letter, apparently Sandy Galef can tell us, a handwritten letter received by a politician has the mass of how many emails, Sandy?
I don't know, several. Emily gets the emails.
Anyway, we're told by lobbyists that a letter, a heartfelt short letter, is very powerful and politicians receive very few of them.
Lauren.
A personal story.
Not a warm email.
I have a question for you all about, do you think there's a connection between the closure of Indian Point and the expansion of the Algonquin pipeline? Do you think Governor Cuomo announced the closure of Indian Point as a way to allow the Algonquin pipeline to expand?
I'm not intimately working on the legal cases on Indian Point, but I've been supporting our staff on that for a long time. I don't think there's a connection there.
I do.
But there is a connection that is a sinister one. In order to assure New Yorkers that we would not have blackouts, the state is in the process of permitting a power cable, largest DC underground, in water DC power cable project and coastal waters on Earth. Hydropower coming down from Canada to feed the New York market. It's equal power in one pair of cables to one Indian Point reactor. I personally opposed that project. I wasn't able to persevere. It's on its way to being permitted. It's going to encourage Canadians to dam rivers. It's going to create electromagnetic fields in the river that will have unknown impacts on migrating fish, which use the Earth's magnetic field for navigation. I think it's a tragedy. And the river constantly has to subsidize us. So we build Indian Point, and then we finally wake up to the day that we're living with a thermonuclear warhead in our neighborhood, and we don't like that. And we realize we can't evacuate. And to save our skins, we permit a cable that is going to destroy Canadian rivers and potentially interrupt migration of these eons-old fish. And that breaks my heart. And, you know, when we finally get to solar and we finally succeed, then maybe the river won't have to subsidize our society anymore. And that's the goal.
I just want to add, very much on the same line, after the fracking ban, Josh Fox, I don't know if any of you know him,
yes.
He did this movie Gasland, and I and Bethany Yarrow and others did a 17-town tour called the Solutions Grassroots Project, meeting with the people who've been very involved in the fracking ban and saying, now take all that energy and let's put that into renewable energy, because we haven't banned fracking until we actually invest in renewables. And so I would ask of all of us, and I think your political question is spot on. It's not just Andrew Cuomo, it's that politicians are more likely to respond right now to requests to stop things than to start things, because they're hearing a lot more. Just, you know, they're hearing a lot more from people who are saying, stop this, stop this. And you can't stop stopping, because these projects are extremely dangerous and devastating, as you just saw. But I would ask that all of us then also put some of that political energy into demanding the kind of investment we need on a state level and on a federal level into solar, ground source heat pumps, small localized energy sources, taking back our power in a very real way, where the energy sources are going to be different in different areas, but much more sustainable, much more resilient, much more local. And there was a day last year where Germany, which is not a sunny country, I think 85% was last year, 75% 2 years ago, 85% of Germany's electricity needs were met by solar alone on one day last year, because they made a political choice. This is very political, a political choice to invest in solar aggressively. So take a little of your energy and push it that way too.
Okay, we're down to our last question or two, so please go right ahead. Jen, you got someone in?
I think that divesting is probably pretty effective. Which banks are funding these bomb trains and the pipelines? Does anybody know? Is there a list? And everybody should divest from any, well, just take your money out of the banks that are funding these terrible projects.
Acknowledge me.
Thanks for the question, Tom. Learned a lot from you. Still learning. I'm actually not going to cite any specific banks. I think that that's a very important research project for everyone in this room to engage in. Divestment is a critical tool in our collective resistance to the fossil fuel industry. I don't know if everyone heard this, but 2 days ago, if I'm not mistaken, Seattle, the city of Seattle, voted to divest from Wells Fargo. Sorry, to remove their money from Wells Fargo. And just today, Mayor de Blasio, New York City Mayor de Blasio, announced that he's interested in doing something very similar for New York City. That's going to strike a severe blow to the financing of the Dakota Access Pipeline. We need to be looking at every single one of these pipeline projects, these natural gas lines, everything, and exploring how are we going to actually hit them in their pocketbooks. It's a vital tactic. It actually allows for community participation. So,
thank you. We have one last question here, and then I'm going to ask all the panelists to give us their comments.
Thank you. I just wanted to mention that a lot of the companies that we're hearing about, you can become a shareholder in any of these companies by buying one share of any of these companies. And if you then send a letter as a shareholder, that will carry a lot more weight than you as a private citizen. And also you'll be getting all kinds of information on findings and who's selling stock and inside information on the companies that you don't ordinarily get. And you will definitely not see greed in the media. So. If you become a part of this process from the inside, I think it would also be helpful from the outside and the inside. Thank you.
Thank you all so much for joining us. I'm going to ask all our panelists to give us their final thoughts, and as perhaps you can include in your final thoughts, some of what we've been talking about here tonight, if there's one thing that we're all going to do when we walk out of this room to make a difference. I think there's an awful lot of desire for some marching orders from this room. And I want to thank everybody for joining us. I hope that you will come back for future documentary discussion screenings. If you signed in when you were here, you'll be getting an email so that we can let you know what's coming up. So, to our panelists.
I'm the guinea pig again. Can y'all hear me?
Yep.
Okay, cool. Some closing words. It's actually difficult to know where to end or begin with all of this. Several months ago, I had the opportunity to travel out to North Dakota to witness firsthand and stand in solidarity with the water protectors that are out there. The biggest lessons that I learned there is that resistance comes in a lot of different forms. And I was particularly struck by the inclusion and the importance of prayer in the work that's going on out there. I'm not a religious person, but participating in prayer while we're participating in direct action and just the action of being fully present to the fights that we're all engaged in is vitally important. It's very, very easy in this work to burn out. I think a lot of us have been there before in a state of burning out. And I believe and what I learned on the front lines out in North Dakota is that importance of being present. A few, couple dozen miles from here in Pennsylvania, there are 72 or so proposed compressor stations and natural gas power stations proposed for the state of Pennsylvania. And all of that infrastructure, in one way or another, is going to impact New York State. It's gonna come through over the border, through New Jersey and into New York State. We have a lot of fights on the horizon. So if I could just leave you all with one thought, it's the importance of radical acts of self-care right now. Part of that is being present, but it's really about taking care of ourselves, taking care of our communities, and all of the fights we're waging.
Well, back at Ossining High School on Monday, I will be back with the kids again. And every year, the Environmental Club and my environmental science classes, we go down to something called A Day in the Life of Hudson River. And it's amazing because there's a fair number of students who live in Ossining and never really go to the river other than to get on the train. And so we go down the river and we do a variety of different science experiments, and it goes on all up and down the river. But the one thing I'm trying to get the kids to see is that the river belongs to them, and it belongs to all of us. And one thing I've learned in teaching is you'll learn better and you'll do more with what you learn when you take ownership for what you learn. So what I would say to anyone is, you know, the river belongs to you, but beyond that, the environment belongs to us. This is going global. It's really a little frightening, and I tell you, November 9th was a very intriguing day in Ossining High School. A lot of kids were outright scared. And there was a girl who was, you know, she was really upset. And I said, you know what? Engage. Yes, it's hard and it's scary and you're angry. But you know what? Do some of the suggestions that have been made. And even for high school kids, there's a lot they can do. And I've had kids that have participated in demonstrations, but I want them to do more. So we're doing our little things. We're trying to open the beach. I have them involved in some science things. There's a really good eel study, and not your eels, but that's, you know, no, but that's an important thing in that, you know, we're studying animals and we're looking at their impact. And yes, there is a, you know, there is a right. We are concerned about human health, absolutely. But, you know, it's Aldo Leopold in his book, we don't own the environment, we're part of the environment. So that's what I try to get my kids to see. And, you know, they're getting there. It's gonna take a while, but I have some students, hi Pedro, here right now. So, you know, so that's where we start. And they bring it on home. But you can all get involved in that too. Educate yourselves and get involved.
Thank you for what you're doing. So I guess religion was mentioned, so I'm gonna just bring it down to make it a revival meeting. Because there are people in North Dakota standing up to their waist in the water protecting sacred land. So I'm gonna ask you to stand up to your waist. You do have a special power because of your connection to the Hudson River and because we are right at the center of these fossil fuel fights in a way that isn't obvious, right? People in Indiana don't know that. But I hope in 3 years they know that, because Ossining is known around the country as one of the most active places fighting against the fossil fuel infrastructure. So what I will ask is, as you're being buffeted by the lies and the cruelty of the existing administration, is that you don't just follow the whatever is happening today, but make a commitment to sometime in the next month, and then the next month, once a month, do something more than talk to your friends about it, more than do something online. So can you do that?
Yes.
Can you do that? Because we really, really need it. I mean, the need is so great. There's Demosthenes said, because Philip II was coming towards Athens to destroy it. And he said, you know, the worst thing is the people who just sit around and gossip about Philip II and say, is he ill? Is he having a bad day? Why gossip about a possible future destruction when you can actually stand up and fight against it? So, what I want to say is I want to give you a lot of permission to gossip about Donald Trump and how terrible he is. And a lot of permission to talk about how you wish the Democratic Party was doing something different. But don't count that as your activism. Does that make sense? So make sure that you're doing more than sharing with your friends on Facebook and complaining. And you can say, that's important to me. That's like coffee hour. But separately, I will make a commitment because I care about this river, because I care about this land, and because I care about this country, to stand up and use the special power you have because of the connection to the river to fight for it. Thanks.
Thank you.
Thank you.
What she said. You know, if every one of us wrote a letter to Governor Cuomo, a respectful letter saying, Governor, we've seen Bowermaster's films, and could you do everything in your power to prevent fossil fuel from moving through the state of New York, whether it's a gas pipeline, or it's an oil train, or it's a barge? And if everyone happened to write that letter in the next month, it would be more letters than he's received on that subject ever. And so, you know, what everyone has said here, exactly. But find your way of engaging. if you're here because of the Hudson and your affection for the Hudson, it's wonderful. And you know what I am so lucky because I get to spend so many days out on the river, and because I'm a grumpy person, I'm often alone. And I get the time to think about it, just to think about it. And the river, for me, is a living thing. It's not a form of life that I completely recognize, but it's a living river. And it's, I feel it saying, you know, because it can't really, it's mute. It looks at us, and I feel it saying, I'm counting on you to do the right thing. So you guys, find your way. Help him teach his kids and sample at the beach. Join an organization, write a letter, write the governor, get involved, and it'll make a difference.
Thank you.
Thank you.
In a room filled with so many inspiring stories and people. And yes, Paul, quickly, you have a question?
There's been so much information this evening, I'm wondering if people have forgotten about being friends of the series.
Oh, you mean people like these people?
Those people.
Is it possible to become a friend of the series right now on your way out the door? Yes. We do have to exit quickly, but on your way, stop at one of the tables, and there's a lovely decorated box with butterflies on it. But let me just point out, you can put your donation in there, and I also want to say a special shout out. There are so many incredible volunteers that make this happen, and people in our community do a wonderful job. We partner with the Ossining Library to be here every month. The executive director is here today, and she's the person who went and got a whole bunch more chairs for us so we could all have seats. Thank you, Karen Marangatel. And then I also want to thank Katie, Jen, can you put that Riverkeeper sweeps thing back up there? Okay, no, there you go. Okay, thank you to Riverkeeper for being our partners. And this gal right here, Jade Benson, that's her. She's a volunteer with the Documentary Discussion Series. She's here with Riverkeeper, and she is the organizer for the Riverkeeper Sweep. What? Oh my gosh, and it's her birthday. We're so happy to have these young people help amazing that. And you can listen to me as you're walking out. I'm not trying to keep you here. Our other partner is Green Ossining. That's who gives us these wonderful water bottles.
What are they doing? A dance?